Okay, we're still talking about types and shadows, and we're gonna start in Exodus chapter 12. And I feel like I'd like to hear where y'all are going. What do you feel like that you're heading? What's the direction for your life? 10 years from now, where are you going to be?
In the ministry, Lord willing.
Yeah. What kind of ministry?
I'll probably want to escape worship.
Yeah.
But then I could see going overseas.
Going overseas?
I'd really like that, yeah.
Any particular country?
I love Italy. I've been over there once, but we'll see. I'm not too particular.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, you said, the Lord willing. Do you feel like God has called you to that?
Lord willing is in, I've never seen myself living to be old age, so 10 years is a while, but Lord willing if it'll get me there.
Yeah. Crutch, what about you?
I guess kind of the same sound, but I see myself teaching for a couple of years at high school, and then also trying to do a youth pastor part-time.
So. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you'd like to be a youth pastor? Yeah. James, what about you?
I don't know.
You don't know?
I really don't. I used to know, but things have happened the past 2 years.
Yeah.
It kind of made me, freaked out, I guess.
Yeah. Well, you know, the thing that God does is that, Ephesians 2:10 says we're His workmanship. For years I thought I was my workmanship. I thought I was always working on me. But when I saw that I was His workmanship, and my responsibility in that is that I yield to Him to allow Him to do the work that He wants to do. I don't do the work. I yield to do what you want to. But we are His workmanship, recreated in Christ Jesus unto good works, which He foreordained before the foundation of the earth that we walk in. So before He said, let there be light, He had a destination for all three of them. He had a place that He wanted you to be. He actually had designed you for that work. And so you never do look at yourself and say, well, I don't know, I can't do. What you can do, and what you're perfectly designed to do, is the work that He created you to do. And the sobering part about that is, nobody else can do it. You're the only one that's designed for that. And so He puts it in your heart. It's a tug. It's an inclination. It's a desire. Oh, I'd like to. Oh, if I could snap my fingers and be, this is where I would like to be. That's the part of the instrument that He's made. He's made it to have a desire to go do what it is that He designed you to do. And so I always say, follow your heart. And if the Lord begins to draw you to a particular thing, the main thing is totally yield your life and don't disobey. That's the key. I was mowing my yard one day, had a riding lawnmower, I was going back and forth, and the Lord said, son, I've called you to teach and exhort. And I said, Lord, I know that, thank you. And I I moved over another part of the yard and I was mowing along the street, and a guy came by in a vehicle and he's going real slow, and I live in a cul-de-sac and I know everybody lives in my part of it, you know, and so I knew he wasn't part of us. And going slow, he always gets your attention, like, is he casing the place, you know, stuff like that. So I watched him, and he drove down and went through, turned in the cul-de-sac, went out. Then all at once I see him coming back. He's driving real slow, and he turned into my driveway. And so I went down, mowed down to where he was and turned off my mower. And he gets out and he says, I've lost my way. I need someone to teach and exhort me. I'm like, well, the Lord just told me just over here on the other side of the yard that I've called you to teach and exhort. And this guy drives in the driveway and says, I need somebody to teach and exhort me. And I said, well, you've come to the right place. I said, come on in. And he came, and I got a couple of lawn chairs, and we sat out in the driveway. So I said, he said, I don't know. He said, I don't know. I just want to serve God, and I don't know. I'm not doing what I need to do. I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing. I said, well, let me ask you a couple questions. I said, do you want to do the will of God more than you want to take your next breath? He said, absolutely. I want to do the will of God more than I want to breathe. And more than the next heartbeat, I want to do the will of the Father. I said, okay. I said, have you ever heard the call of God without a doubt on your life and ask you to go here, do this, and you didn't do it? He said, no, I've never done that. I said, well, I've got some really good news for you. You're right on track. And it's impossible for you to miss it. Whatever God's got for you, it's impossible. It's impossible for you to miss what he's got for you. And he was working out at Firestone. He was throwing big inner tubes. They come off the supply thing, and he'd throw those things. And it's hot and hard work. And I said, you need to go back to Firestone, and you need to throw your inner tubes, and you need to let the Lord teach you. And there's some lessons you're needing to learn where you are. And whenever you've learned your lessons and you're ready to go for the next step, boom, he'll pop you out of there. And he went on his way. And I really believe that's true for everybody. And so, anyway, everybody has been called differently. My wife and I were eating in it was a cafeteria in North Little Rock years ago. We had finished eating and we were leaving the restaurant, and I noticed two couples sitting in a booth over here next to the wall. And when I saw them, I just went into the spirit and I heard myself talking. I heard myself and saw myself in the spirit going over and talking to them, and I said, are y'all ministers? And they looked at me and they said, now this is in the spirit, not in the natural. And they said, yeah, we are, we're ministers. And then they actually talked a little bit about that. They said, are you a minister? Well, I've never been on staff in the church. I've never, you know, so I'm like, well. And so the Lord said, well, are you or not? I said, yes, Lord, I know you called me to be a minister. I'm just a different kind of minister. And so I paid my check, and my wife and I, we walked out the front of the restaurant and got in the parking lot. Here comes a man running across the parking lot hollering, are you a minister? Are you a minister? Well, I just answered that to the Lord inside the house, inside the building. And I said, yeah. He said, well, would you come over here to my van and talk to me and my wife? He said, I feel like God is calling me to go to seminary, and she doesn't want to go, and we were on our way to Memphis to sign up for seminary, and and she is not wanting to go, and I want you to come over here and talk to us. So I got there in that van. My wife wondered where in the world I'd gone. You're getting in a van with the people that you don't know. It's just, you know, you're gonna get mugged or whatever. So I'm sitting in that van, and he began to talk, and she began to talk, and so after a while I told him, I told the man, you turn this thing around, you turn this van around, and you go home. I said, whenever you're ready to go, whenever God's ready for you to go, your wife's going to be in agreement. He doesn't just call one of you. He's going to call both of you. And she's not called. And so I'm telling you to go home, and you do whatever. And whenever God completes his calling on both of you, then you're going to be in agreement. You go to seminary. I saw the man. Actually, I didn't know it at the time, but the guy was from Dover. We were in Little Rock. I was preaching in Dover one time, and he came up after the service, and he said, I don't know if you remember me, and he told me this situation, and I did remember it. He said, I didn't know it, but I was mentally ill. And he said, I came back like you told me to, and I got stabilized and I got healthy, and said, God has mightily blessed us. And I'm like, so, you know, God does things differently. I know exactly where I was and the situation whenever God called me into the ministry, but I've never, it's a different type of ministry. Anybody would wonder about it, you know. So anyway, a ministry doesn't necessarily mean pastoring a church or whatever. There's ministers all over the world in different capacities. I don't know. I felt like I needed to say that because I saw that coming up the stairs, and I'm like, that's not what we're supposed to talk about. But I felt like the Lord wanted me to talk about that. I don't know who that's for. But anyway, there it is. All right, Exodus chapter 12. It says, and the Lord spoke unto Moses and to Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. And speak unto the congregation of Israel, saying, in the tenth day of this month, they shall take unto them every man a lamb. Now, if you have a Bible that you can underline in, I would underline a lamb. You don't have a Bible, James?
I need
to find one. We're going to be looking at a lot of scripture.
I got my hat.
Okay. According to the house of the fathers, a lamb for a house. And if the household be too small, too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man according to his eating shall make your count for the lamb. So you might want to underline the lamb. Now in verse 5, it says your lamb. You might want to underline your lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it out from the sheep and from the goats, or from the goats. And you shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it. In the King James it says, in the evening. Now actually, in my margin it says between the evenings. Now between the evenings, the day starts at 6 o'clock in the morning. So that's the first hour. The first hour would be an hour after sunrise. 12 o'clock would be sixth hour. And then you have the first evening would start then. And then at 6 o'clock you're going to have the second evening. So you've got from 12 until 6. You got the first evening, the second evening starting at 6 in the afternoon or in the evening. And so between the evenings would be three. So that's when you're supposed to, that's when you're supposed to kill it. And so from there, we're talking about types and shadows. Now this type right here is a type of crucifixion. It's Jesus is the Lamb. In John 1:29, whenever John the Baptist is baptizing and he saw Jesus coming, he says, "Behold the Lamb." So Jesus is that Lamb. He is the sacrificial Lamb. And this is a type or a shadow of what is to come. And so the progression here that I want you to note was, first of all, a lamb in verse 3. And in verse 4, the lamb. Now, there's a lot of people who, if you ask them, they believe that Jesus is a real person. They believe he's the Son of God. But there's a point here to where it has to become very personal. And that's the reason verse 5 says, your lamb. I can believe that Jesus died for you, and I believe you were born again, but that does not affect me. It's got to be where he is my Savior, my Lord, my Lamb. It's got to be, it's got to come to the personal place. And so, let's go to Luke chapter 23. Let's start with verse 41. It says, "And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man has done nothing amiss. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, Verily I say unto you, today ye shall be with me in paradise." And verse 44, it says, "And it was about the sixth hour," so that's noon. "There was a darkness over all the earth until what hour?"
Three
or the ninth hour. Now see, that is the what we just read over in Genesis 12. Or was it Exodus 12? Exodus 12. Where it says, between the evenings. Mm-hmm. Here it is. Mm-hmm. It's right here that Jesus is that Lamb. Right. And he is being sacrificed at exactly the same time that the lamb is to be offered or to kill, be killed. Now what's happening over in the temple is that what we read in Exodus 12 is being fulfilled over in the temple. They are killing a lamb and they are putting the blood on the mercy seat. And whenever the priest would go into the Holy of Holies, and he would put the blood of the lamb on the mercy seat for the atonement of the sins of the people. And then he would come out and he would put his hands up to his mouth and he would holler to the crowd, "Tetelestai." And the tetelestai is, it's finished. Your sins have been taken care of. On the cross, Jesus is crying, his last words are, "Tetelestai, your sins are forgiven, your sins are covered, the lamb has been slain, and the blood is being applied, and your sins are covered." They're simultaneously, with the type and the shadow, the real is coming to fruition. And so, whenever you're talking about types and shadows, you're seeing a picture of it in the Old Testament, and it's coming to reality in the New Testament, or the typical versus the atypical. The typical or the type versus the antitype or the real. And so we have that real being offered, and so it's another one of the types and shadows. So that's what we're studying. Any thoughts on that?
I like that.
It's just absolutely good stuff. Now, up in the upper room before this, that Jesus observed the Passover supper early because he was going to be involved when it actually happened. And when he took the bread, he said, "This is my body, which is broken." Now he was getting ready to be whipped and beaten with a cat of nine tails, and his flesh is going to be torn from his body, and it's going to be fulfilled of what was said of him in Isaiah 55, that he took our sins and our griefs upon his body, and his body is marred, and his visage was changed to where that you couldn't even recognize him. That's what he did. Now, the bread he's taking, he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." That's where we get the fact that he died, he took our sins and our sicknesses on his body in that hour. And then he took the cup and he said, "This is the new testament or the new covenant in my blood." Now, I talked to you last time, a couple of you weren't here, but I talked to you last time about the Abrahamic covenant and the fact that whenever a covenant was consummated, that you would take heifers and goats and things, and you would make two rows of them, and you'd walk between the pieces, and you would make a declaration, and you would recite the issues or the details of the covenant that you were making, and then you would say, "Let it be done unto me as has been done unto these animals if I don't fulfill all the details of this covenant." And then you would exchange names. And so we saw that happen with Abram being named, changed to Abraham and so forth. So, but it was a blood covenant. And so Jesus is saying, "This is the new covenant. And I'm going to be that sacrificial part that's going to be killed. And my blood is going to be spilled." And it's the blood. It's a blood covenant. And so when he takes the cup, he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant." So it's a powerful, powerful picture. And we have the Old Testament type. We have the New Testament atypical or antitype. Okay, any questions on that? Good? All right, turn with me to Numbers. Numbers chapter 21. One of the greatest messages, salvation messages that you'll ever see is right here. Numbers chapter 21. Let's just start with the first of the chapter. And when King Arad, the Canaanite, which dwelt in the south, heard tell that Israel came by the way of the spies, then he fought against Israel and took some of them prisoners. And Israel vowed a vow unto the Lord and said, "If thou wilt indeed deliver this people into my hand, then I will utterly destroy their cities." And the Lord hearkened to the voice of Israel and delivered the Canaanites, and they utterly destroyed them and their cities, and he called the name of the place Hormah. And they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to compass the land of Edom, and the soul of the people was much discouraged because of the way. Now, I minister to people like this all the time. They're discouraged because of the way. It's hard. And there's some real lessons to be learned in this. And the people spoke against God and against Moses. "Wherefore have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no bread, neither is there any water, and our soul loatheth this light bread." Now they're getting manna every day. And they They didn't like it, so they began to murmur and complain. I wouldn't recommend it as a believer. I would not recommend that. If you have cares, cast them on the Lord. But don't. Let me just give you a basic thing that I do. And if I ever get into a situation, I don't know what's going on. There's one rule that I always follow. I never, ever blame God for the situation. What I always do is I say, Lord, I'm missing it somewhere here. Have I made an error? Have I gone the wrong way? Have I disobeyed? Have I sinned? Have I done this? I always look at me. I never blame Him. Because He's a good God. And every good and every perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, in whom there is no variableness, neither is a shadow of turning. He's a good God. He always has been good, and He never will be any other way. It's impossible for Him to change. So I start with that basic premise. And I will go from there to see if I can determine an answer to what's going on with me. But they complain. Now, in verse 6, and you got to understand that the way the Lord dealt with people in the Old Testament is different than the way He deals with people in the New Testament. It says, and the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and much people of Israel died. So these fiery serpents, they are, hold on. Good. So the fiery serpents, they bit the people, and this fever would spring up in them, and it would destroy them. Verse 7, therefore the people came to Moses, and they said, we have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against you. Pray unto the Lord that He take away the serpents from us. And Moses prayed for the people. So you have a picture of intercession, and you have Moses being an intercessor, and you have the people sinning, and you have people dying because they've sinned. Okay, we get the picture. So in verse 8 it says, the Lord said unto Moses, make a fiery serpent, and set it upon a pole, and it shall come to pass that every one that is bitten, when he looks upon it, shall live. So we have a problem, and we have a remedy. And the remedy was for Moses to take this brass serpent, put it on a pole, and you raise the pole up, and as many would look on the pole, the effects of the fiery serpent bite, poof, they're healed. Verse 9, and Moses made a serpent of brass and put it on a pole, and it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, I'd like to underline that, any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived. So it was a thing of look and live. Look and live. So if you go back to the camp of Israel, and we'll say they're living in tents, they're definitely transient. They're passing through. And here's a man. He's been bitten. And he's in his tent. He's dying. His wife comes to him and says, honey, listen, you don't have to die. Moses went to God, and God told him to make a brass serpent and put it on a pole, and if anybody would look on it, they could live. And so she throws back the flap of the tent and says, honey, just look. And he says, Woman, are you telling me, are you talking about the brass serpent theory? Are you talking about, I mean, get real. Get real. How could that affect anything? And the man dies because he wouldn't look, because he thought it was nonsense. Let's turn to John 3. And we know John 3:16. We're going to go to John 3:14. Talking about types and shadows. John 3:14. It says, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, we've got to read about that, didn't we? Even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Now why was the serpent lifted up? He was lifted up because people had sinned, and the sin had taken its toll on people, and people were going to die. Now, that represents not only physical death, but eternal death. Because every man is bitten by the serpent, fiery serpent of sin. Every man is bitten. So every man needs to look and live. And so here, verse 15, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now, the look in the Old Testament is believe in the new. In the Old Testament, look at the brass serpent on the pole, and you will live. In the New Testament, believe. If you look, if whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So, he was, it's the exact same picture. Jesus going up on a cross. The serpent going up on a pole. Look to the brass serpent on the pole and you'll live. Believe that Jesus is dying for you and you'll live. They're exactly this. One is the type and the other one is the antitype. So we have the perfect picture. And there's one other thing that we need to note here. Let's read on. It says, For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believes on him is not condemned, but he that believes not is condemned already. Okay. Now, a person that does not believe is already condemned. Now, you have the fiery serpent bite, and everybody is bitten. And everybody is condemned. They're going to die because they have been bitten. They've been bitten by sin. And it says that Jesus didn't come to condemn anybody. They were already condemned. They were condemned because they had sinned and death had come upon them. Now, verse 18, let me read that again. He that believes on him is not condemned, but he that believes... But he that believes not is condemned already. Now, the word that I have next to my Bible is because. You have that? Because. You got the because. Now, anytime you see a because, you need to just kind of, okay, I need to look and see why. It's going to tell why they were condemned. He was condemned because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Now, this really helps me whenever I'm out witnessing. A person can tell me that they've been in drugs, alcohol, sex, every kind of perversion. I mean, the list is long. But that's not the reason that they're condemned. It doesn't say that they're condemned because they've done these things. They're condemned because they have not believed in the only begotten Son of God. I don't deal with sin in a lost person. I don't even talk about it. I was right over here where these Vista apartments are. It was before those were built, and it used to be college housing. And then they were purchased, and it was low rent housing for a long time. And I stopped there, and there was a man sitting out on an old car seat that had been put out in the yard, just kind of a seat to sit on. And he was sitting on that thing. I went up to him. I began to give him the gospel. And he had stopped me, and he said, hold. He said, sir, he said, you don't know who I am. And he said, and you don't know what I've done. So evidently, he was saying, I've got a long history of being bad, but you don't know who I am. And you have no idea what I've done. And all at once, I spoke to him by the Spirit. I mean, I never thought of this ever. And I said, sir, it's not about who you are. And it's not about what you've done. It's about who Jesus is and what he's done. That is the issue we have here. I don't care who you are, and I don't care what you've done. Here's the deal. This is who Jesus is, and this is what he did. If you will put your faith and your trust in who he is and what he's done, you will have eternal life. He sat there and said, oh my goodness. And he prayed to receive Christ. And I'm telling you, that revelation right there, if you start dealing with a person's all the junk, it's just back in the Old Testament, in Numbers 21, whenever they said, look and live. They didn't say, repent, get rid of all the junk, and then look and you'll live. No, they didn't say that, did it? It just simply said, look and live. And in the New Testament, here, look to Christ and believe. It's faith plus nothing. If you ever put any other requirement on eternal life, you are not preaching the gospel. It's Jesus alone. Put your trust and your faith in him. And, I have a great deal of confidence in a person who will cry out, Lord Jesus, save me. Lots of confidence. Close there in John. Look at John 5 and 24. Very, very, I say to you, he that believes on my word, here's my word, and believes on him that sent me has everlasting life. You might want to underline has. It's not will have. It's has. It's not had. It's has. Present tense. You know, I love that nature of God. He always has been, is. He is, and he always will be, is. He's present tense, always. And it says, and believes on him that sent me, has everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Look at Philippians 1:6. This is Paul. He says, He says he hadn't been able to get with them, but he's hadn't had the opportunity to come to them. But he says, verse 5 says, "For your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ." There's lots of people that I lead to the Lord and I never see them again. And sometimes I worry about it. But here's the deal. This is what I'm confident of. The Word of God is eternal. If they receive that, they got it inside of them, I'm confident of this one thing. He is going to complete his work until the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. I used to go up to the jail used to be on the top of the courthouse downtown. And I used to go up there, I believe it was every Monday or Tuesday, I'm not sure what day, the same day every week. We'd go up there and we'd witness to people in jail. I always saw so many people saved. And one day, I was driving by the courthouse, and I'd been up there the night before, and I was worried about the people that I'd led to the Lord, and I said, "Oh, God, you know, they're up there. They don't have anybody to teach them. They don't have anybody to this." And the Lord said, "Son, you gave my word. My word is in them. They'll be fine." I'm like, "Oh, my God." It's good, you know. So, anyway. All right. Let's see where we want to go now. All right. Let's go to Numbers 13. I actually preached this type and this picture the last time I preached was week before last Sunday, a week ago yesterday. But a lot of y'all were gone to Hot Springs, I think. So let's look at Numbers 13 and we'll start with verse 16. Now here's what the Lord said. I told you that coming out of Egypt was like coming out of the world. Coming across the Red Sea is like baptism. The rod that Moses held is like the name of Jesus. And the wilderness experience is like the carnal Christian life. You're alive, but it's not very good. It's not very much fun. You're not in Egypt where the leeks and the garlic and all the good things are, and you're not in the promised land. It's a land flowing with milk and honey. You're in a no man's land. And a Christian who is living a carnal life is a man or a woman that's miserable. It's a miserable existence. And that's what Paul said to the people of Corinth that Tim was preaching about yesterday. He says, I can't even talk to you spiritual. I've got to talk to you as carnal. Your mind and your thinking, the way you're living and what you're doing is not like a Christian. It's like a carnal. It's like an in-betweener. you got a foot in both worlds. And you need to get you need to get both feet in the kingdom of God and walk in the Spirit. But anyway, so they're in the wilderness. But here's the thing. The scripture says, God said, "I brought you out that I might bring you in." It was supposed to be a three-day journey. It's supposed to be a three-day journey from the Red Sea to the Jordan. It takes them 40 years. And it's supposed to be a three-day journey. And God never intends for a person to live in the wilderness. You get born again that you can get baptized in the Spirit and go into the promised land and fight the giants. Now that's what you were designed to do. And so here we have where he's telling them, I want you to get a person from each tribe, and I want you to assemble the 12 men, and I want you to send them over there. And here's the land is a land flowing with milk and honey. And I want you to go over there and spy out the land. So they do. They go over there. And in verse 13:25. And they returned from searching of the land after 40 days. Now, the 40 days is significant. They spent 40 years in the wilderness, and there was one day for each of the years. You go back and you read that another time. But, and they went and they came to Moses and Aaron and all the congregation of the children of Israel unto the wilderness of Paran to Kadesh, and brought back the word unto them and unto all the congregation, and showed them the fruit of the land. Now, it was another place up at verse 23 says, and they came unto the brook of Eshcol, and cut down from thence a branch with one cluster of grapes, and they bare it between two upon a staff, and he brought of the pomegranates and of the figs. It was just absolutely one branch took two people and put it on staff to carry it. I don't know if you've ever seen grapes grow, but that's a bunch of grapes, a lot of big grapes. Anyway, it was just exactly like God said it was. Verse 27, and they told him and said, we came unto the land which you sent us to, and surely it flows with milk and honey, and this is the fruit of it. So they showed him, and it's like, wow. Now then, verse 28, you got that nevertheless. Now, whenever you see those, you're getting ready to see some unbelief. Nevertheless, the people be strong that dwell in the land, and the cities are walled and very great. And moreover, we saw the children of Anak there. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south, and the Hittites and the Jebusites and the Amorites dwell in the mountains, and the Canaanites dwell by the sea and by the coast of Jordan. Now, this is another type you just need to be aware of, that all those different groups represent in the spirit realm demons, principalities, powers, rulers of darkness. They're there. Now, we're in the kingdom of light, but I'm telling you, as we move, we're going to encounter, just because they went into the promised land, it didn't mean that it was just absolutely heaven. No, there's still wars to take place there. A lot of people, they make even have songs, and the songs represent the promised land as being heaven. Wrong. There's war over there. There is absolutely war going over in the promised land. And I'm telling you, a Christian that's alive and awake in this day recognizes that the kingdom of God, there are giants to be killed. And so let's go ahead and read this. Now, in verse 30 it says, and Caleb still the people before Moses said, let us go up at once and possess it. We're well able to overcome it. Now, that's what I'm just kind of trying to tell you right there. You are well able to take them. You're well able. And whenever I say that, I hope you understand what I'm saying. I'm not able. I'm dirt. I've been formed up clay. But I'm telling you, what's in me is able. He who is in me is able. So, every time I go to minister to a person, I always tell them this. Listen, look at me. I can't save you. I can't heal you. I can't deliver you. And I tell them that for two reasons. One is, I do not want them looking to me as their source. I do not want to be your source. God is your source. He, if there's anything done in your life, it's going to be Him. It's not going to be me. It's going to be Him. Do you understand that? Yes, I understand that. Now, I tell them that also because I need to hear it. Now, I'm just telling you, for a man that has ministered hundreds and hundreds of times, you have to be careful. You can get to where you think you can do. You can get to a point where, oh yeah, bring them on. I can take care of that. Oh. I absolutely had there's a man that's demonized here in this town right now, and I was asked last week if I would minister to him. And I said I would do it. And I'm ashamed to tell you this. I am. I'm just ashamed to tell you this. Whenever I said I'll do it, I was thinking, yeah, I'll bring him on. And I got away. I said, oh, God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, God. For me to ever think I could do it. I called and I said, I'm not doing it. I've got to repent. I've got to get my heart right. I go in there thinking like that, I'm gonna get my butt kicked. I'm just telling you, be careful. Don't get arrogant and thinking, oh yeah. I'll do that. Yeah, I'll come minister to you. I can do that. Oh, be careful. You can't do anything except he empower you to do it. Now, you just got to remember that. If you ever, and I'm telling you, I called him back and I said, give me at least another week. I'm not going to do that right now. And I didn't tell him why I wasn't going to do it, but I'm telling you, is because I had lifted up my heart to the point that I said, yeah, I've done this before and I can do it again. And I'm like, oh, no, no. I know that's not right. And I just ask you to forgive me for any kind of thinking. That's vain thinking. And I, does that make any sense?
Yeah.
So, I always tell them I can't help you, but I know who can. We're a couple of beggars. We found bread. We don't have bread. We know who has the bread. And we know that if we go to him, he'll get you the bread you need. Now that's the way we minister. As Dave and I were talking in the office before we came, we're priests. Now you need to get this picture in your mind. You're a priest. We're a kingdom of priests. Now, a priest, this is what a priest does. A person comes to you and they have a need. So you reach over as a priest and you take hold of the need. And you hold it and you say, hold on just a second. And you reach up and you get the hand of God who has the supply. And you get the supply and the need together. He has the supply. They have the need. You're the priest. You're the go-between. You're believing. Hold on just a second. My Father's got all you need. Hold on. Let me hold on to you. And Father, I'm asking. My friend has come and they have a need and I'm asking you to supply their need. And that's what we are. We're a kingdom of priests. We're a kingdom of priests. We're a royal priesthood. And so we are priests in the earth and we are going about. And whenever we run across that need, we take our priestly duty and we take hold of that need and we take hold of the hand of God and we believe God to supply the need. Does that make sense to you? All right. Now I'm telling you, what I'm telling you will save you some heartache. It will save you some heartache and it will save you from gross error if you will just follow it. Now, verse 31, but the men that went up with him said, we be not able to go up against the people, for they're stronger than we are. Well, duh, they're stronger than we are. I'm telling you, whenever the curtain pulled back and I saw that thing, if I would have sat there and evaluated that and said, is that thing bigger and stronger than me? Well, that is a no-brainer. Of course it is. I mean, it was huge. It had fire in its eyes. It had horns on its... And they came back and said, oh, we can't do it because they're bigger than us. That is, you see, all right. And they brought up an evil report of the lamb which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, the lamb through which we have gone to search it is a lamb that eats up the inhabitants thereof, and all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which which some of the giants, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. Now listen, that is a major, major understanding. Don't look at yourself. We were in our sight grasshoppers. If you ever go into an evaluation of who you are to go and to fight these battles in the heavenlies, if you ever at one time look and evaluate yourself, you will fail every time. You cannot look at yourself and evaluate yourself and see how you stack up against them. You do not stack up. And whenever they view themselves like that, then what they viewed, they said, okay, they see themselves as grasshoppers and we will agree with it. But what they did not see was God. What they did not see and what they did not know, that is, God is so much bigger than any one of them. And so, whenever you evaluate the situation, all you need to know is, Lord, are you wanting me to do something here? Are you wanting me to do it? And whenever you approach it in that way, then you're going to be on much better ground. You hear the voice of the Lord.